It's not on?
No, it's on. It has to be already.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Welcome back to our wonderful conference about family values and the link to economic well-being and social outcomes. I hope you had a very good lunch break and are not too tired. Normally after lunch we get a little bit down with our attention level, but I can promise you we are going to have a very exciting new panel, probably the best of the whole conference. Myself is Dieter Schmidt. I'm working in Germany in the UPF, and I'm married and have three daughters, and I work as a doctor, and I look at the whole topic very much from a practical point of view. I'm very honored and grateful to be here because I learned so much about the importance and value of the family. And I can assure you, maybe the next conference, we can add something, family values and the link to their physical health, because it's so directly related. So I hope that can be included next time. Now it is my pleasure to introduce the first speaker, who is my dear friend and also colleague. We are working together in the UPF Germany, but more than that, he is the vice president of the Christian Democratic Party in Stuttgart, Germany. He is really an active man, not just a talker. Just 2 days ago, he was the main organizer of a big demonstration in the Stuttgart city, where they were demonstrating for the family values and marriage. And he himself is also married and has three children. So now it's my pleasure to introduce to you Karl Christian Hausmann. It's your floor.
Thank you very much, Dieter. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. He exaggerates always a little bit. I wasn't the main organizer. I supported this demonstration. I have to correct that and give credit and honor to those who did the main work. What can I contribute to this conference is my question. I think in the best case, I can give you a report about recent events that took place in Stuttgart that have the effect to encourage you, to empower you, and show you that our issue that we have can be brought forward, even if you feel sometimes not so powerful or encouraged. As you know, there's a saying that says many evils exist or can develop only because good people are inactive or sleep or do not do what they could do. And as you all probably have realized, there exists actually an agenda against traditional family and traditional sexual morals that you find in the traditional religions that is brought forward not as an attack openly, but by, for example, LGBT groups, the left groups, political left groups, and also political parties that support these interest groups. So, and at the same time, this agenda is supported, I mean, at least I can say that in Germany, greatly by the media. So you get the impression that this agenda already is supported by a great majority of the people, which in fact is not. And this agenda that I'm talking about is most of the time very nice formulated. It comes across with nice sounding words like demand for diversity, equal rights, open-mindedness versus narrow-mindedness, multicoloredness versus, I don't know what, love versus hate, you know. And someone put it in our last demonstration. He was from the Catholic Forum, a professor from the Catholic Forum. He said, it's a cultural war that is taking place. We didn't want this war. We didn't declare this war. It was forced upon us, but, sounds a bit martialic, but he said, but we're going to win it, you know. And in fact, if you're in the political arena, you really get the impression, I mean, Caroline said what happened here at the UN before this declaration was passed, you really get the impression it's a fight. And what I want to say is, I live in Stuttgart. This is the capital of Southwest Germany, the state of Southwest Germany. And we recently had a change in government. We have now a green and social democratic alliance. It used to be a Christian democratic ruled country for 50 years. And now we have a change in government. And so recently the new government introduced a plan to change the educational educational plan. And what they wanted to change, especially that got into the public, was that students or pupils of all ages, even from elementary schools, should be educated in about all kinds of variation of sexuality. From elementary school on, you know, they should be taught all kinds of forms of sexual activity, and that should become compulsory. Should become also over all issues, all topics in school, even in mathematics. In mathematics, you wonder how homosexuality should show up in mathematics, but. Then you would have not a boy and a girl go shopping and they buy £1 here for the, but then Hans and Fritz, who are married, go into and, you know, no matter what, physics, biology, everywhere, this should be taught. And these curriculars were on the internet, and especially the government asked the union and LGBT groups to help them develop this curricula. And when that got out, actually one teacher, Stengele, he was the first one to discover it, and he minded it. And he started an online petition. And to the surprise of the government, within 2 or 3 weeks, it got 200,000 signatures, which was quite amazing. And he said, for example, that actually stirred up a big controversy. He said, among homosexuals, the suicide rate is much higher, and all these topics, I don't see how this is not talked about. And then the discussion started. Are they committing suicide because they are discriminated? There's discrimination in schools and so on. And the whole debate got going. 200,000 signatures. Actually, the government was quite arrogant, saying we don't care about these signatures. We were not influenced by this. Anti-groups started anti-petitions. So two anti-petitions that got altogether like 120,000 signatures. So the issue was out. And then a couple of parents, young couple, had young children. They are from a Orthodox, Russian Orthodox background, called Fromm, Ehepaar Fromm, pious means in German, pious. Nice young couple. They started to say, concerned parents, we make a demonstration against this educational plan. And normally, you know, the normal citizens, Christian democratic citizens, they don't go for demonstrations, right? And immediately the left, they threatened. And so the first demonstration took place, about 800 policemen protecting 1,000 demonstrators. And a lot was going on. But they kind of sang religious songs and so forth, and this demonstration also was widely reported in the media. Eventually, a second demonstration took place, a third demonstration took place, and then finally politics also had to make a statement. So Christian Democratic Union, that I'm part of, I also urged our party to make a statement. And then the statement was that the problem with this new plan is that The family as a guiding principle, as it is stated in the Constitution, is not respected. Also that the state does not respect enough parents' rights. And we also said sexual diversity is overemphasized. Tolerance, of course, naturally, tolerance. Tolerance and discrimination is not acceptable. But people are not mostly discriminated because of their sexual orientation. People are discriminated in schools because they are too fat, they are too thin, they are I don't know what. But they only talk about discrimination because of sexual orientation. Then eventually in this curricula, in this education plan, it asked for acceptance of sexual diversity. Acceptance. And then the Christian Democratic Union made a hearing, and we had a professor on law, a German professor on law, that said that to ask for acceptance is a violation of the prohibition to indoctrinate. I mean, schools are not allowed to indoctrinate. They have to facilitate that pupils can form their own opinion, but they cannot force opinions on pupils. And to ask acceptance is something else than asking tolerance. This is unconstitutional. Because acceptance means you give up your own opinion and you accept another opinion. Tolerance, okay, but there is unconstitutional. So we demanded that they completely withdraw that politically. And then the government got really, shocked, because they didn't expect the bourgeoisie, so to say, to protest. And eventually, after the third demonstration, they said, we delay it for 1 year. And this acceptance of sexual diversity was taken out from the paper. And that, in a way, is a, it's a model case, a precedent that we want to establish in our state, because red-green governments all over Germany are trying to establish that in schools. They want this to be taught everywhere, and they do not want to be talked about homosexuality in the context of tolerance, but they won't even not be taught by heterosexual teachers. Absolutely, homosexual people have to come into the schools and teach. And it's further ongoing. So we say, actually, the norms and values on sexual morality is not the job of the state to teach that. That is left to the, that's our political borderline. It's left to the parents, and there should be an agreement with the parents. And so, in a way, we found that this, that we could stop the government so far, is a great success. And also, in the last demonstration on Saturday, we had our fourth demonstration. I was also one of the speakers. And one good argument that I heard there is, there's a lot of talk about sexual harassment these days in your working place. And one of the speakers said, actually, what they're trying to explain to 8 or 9 or 10 year old students is a example of sexual harassment. If you would do that in your working place to an adult, you immediately would be sued for sexual harassment. Yeah, but they're trying to talk about issues to people that even haven't experienced puberty, and they feel it's shameful, and they do not want to be confronted with this. So, actually, one last fact that I want to report: in the last demonstration, also Muslims participated. Normally, it's a broad alliance that orientates itself on the Manif pour tous example in France. These are Catholic, Protestant, Pietist people, most of the organizations that work for that. And you see, these are the colors from France, who we are. Manif pour tous uses this in the demonstration for all. So actually, there is not one single word that discriminates homosexuals on this demonstration. We always express homosexuals are welcome to work in our party as neighbors in our, but norms, sexual norms and marriage and family should not be given up, and it should be left to the parents. And this time, for the first time, we could have some Muslim organization participate. And this was very good. And it makes the government even more cautious because they're discriminating also the Muslim organizations that so far have, normally the Muslims in Germany are not into politics, but now they're beginning to wake up. So we feel it's very encouraging. We are ready to take up the fight. I mean, I was blamed for participating there a lot in the media, but I mean, unfounded. I'm a nice guy, I'm a loving person, I do not hate anybody, yeah? But nevertheless, I was portrayed as a monster. Yeah. But you have to be ready to be discriminated at first, and then in the end, truth will prevail. So I hope it was encouraging. I'm ready to answer more questions. I try to keep the time. Thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Christian. This is a very, very hopeful to see how we can bring the issue in the political arena and how important it is that we wake up and we have good arguments. And I believe that this conference is helping us so much to find truly very good arguments. Now it is my honor to introduce you to Mr. I hope I pronounce it right, Mr. Drazen U. Cottage. He is the vice president of a very important organization in Croatia. It's called In the Name of the Family. And he represents the president of this organization. This organization has succeeded to make a referendum in Croatia, to bring it into the constitution that the family is seen between a man and a woman. This is what it is. I mean, that's so normal, but we have to fight to bring that into the constitution. So I'm very happy that now Mr. Jukovic will speak to us about this topic. Thank you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I have great honor to greet you in the name of our organization, in the name of the family. And I'm very happy to have the possibility to show you what we did in Croatia to protect marriage and family values. We meet each other here in Geneva to commemorate the 20th anniversary of the International Year of the Family. But the family is today under attack more than ever. Especially the institution of marriage is assaulted. And we know that the marriage is one of the fundamental family forms. If we ask ourselves, is family more protected than 20 years before? And is marriage, is families more protected than before? Our family values are empowered? The answer will certainly not satisfy us. Today, we experience the lack of social support for marriage, and all elements of the common structure of marriage are under attack. Emphasizing sexual preferences tends to ruin and deconstruct the traditional marriage and family structure. We ask ourselves, what will happen to marriage and family in the next 20 years? The answer for us in Croatia was that we must protect the structure of marriage through constitutional amendment. Let me briefly introduce you Croatia. As you have seen, Croatia is located in Southeast Europe, and it is the youngest member of the European Union. It was ruled by Yugoslav Communist Party for 45 years. And after the war for independence, it finally became independent. It's rather small, and 87% of citizens declare themselves as Catholic. Ruling party, using the media under his control, is imposing redefinition of social values, culture, and identity. It started with obligatory sex education 2 years ago, and it continued with abolishing fundamental principles of democracy by imposing an ideology of small and aggressive group on the majority of people. Representatives of the ruling coalition express their intentions in the media to legalize same-sex marriage, parenting and same-sex marriage and parenting and adoption by the end of their mandate. In May 2012, Prime Minister Milanović announced changes in legislation toward marriage equality, similar with the laws on marriage in Spain and Portugal. Concerned that there would be a strong majority in Croatian society against same-sex marriage and that there would be strong opposition from the Catholic Church, the ruling coalition decided to legalize same-sex marriage through a separate law, the law on registered partnership, allowing same-sex couples the same rights as in marriage union. And we wanted to prevent this the situation in France, where millions of people protested on the streets against the government plans to legalize same-sex marriage and adoption, and where the police responded with violence toward the citizens. Referendum ensures that all citizens have the possibility to participate in the creation of the policy. It becomes a correction to government policies and puts a veto on the policies with which citizens do not agree. It was the first referendum in Croatia initiated by citizens and encourages them for further fights for their beliefs. And legal requirements for referendum in Croatia are very hard to achieve. And to collect signatures of at least 10% of all voters in Croatia is like 30 million in the United States. Furthermore, we have only 15 days to accomplish the job. In the Name of the Family has created a network of non-governmental organizations, all relevant religious communities in Croatia, and many political parties. We built national and county networks of volunteers with more than 6,000 of volunteers organized to work in shifts at 2,000 registered locations, which has to be signed by police. Although through the organization of events, media conferences, publications, and so on, we were raising awareness and public sensibility for that topic. In rising awareness, and because of opponent and blocked public media, the website and the social networks played a very, very important role. And our struggle developing two different directions. First, a struggle for family, because marriage is a union between one woman and one man. Marriage is the foundation of a family, and every child, whenever possible, should be raised by mother and a father. And a second struggle was struggle for democracy. Against us were the whole government, President of the Republic of Croatia, large sections of NGOs financed by the government and acting as lobbyist groups, and research of the published articles and other media pieces showed that 75% were against referendum, 15% were neutral, and only 10% of all pieces, media pieces, were in favor of the referendum. And Minister of Foreign Affairs, for example, Minister of Foreign Affairs Vesna Pusić, a few days before referendum said that no matter you, on the public television, no matter you think, you should vote no. And the President of Croatia, Ivo Josipović, said, I will vote no, and you. And many other politicians and ministers follow that example. And we say marriage is woman and men, and anything else is something completely different. With the help of more than 6,000 very young volunteers, we are happy we had so young people with us. And in more than 2,000 locations for collection of signatures. In despite of more than 50 reports to the police because of violent attacks on our volunteers, we are proud that more than 750,000 citizens have signed a request for referendum. And this was the day where we submitted boxes with 750,000 signatures to the president of the parliament, Josip Leko. And through 6 months after that, in strong campaign, ruling coalition attempted to convince the citizens against the referendum, but results of the referendum was excellent. 66% of all citizens said that marriage is a union between woman and a man, and moreover, the turnout was rather high, just 5% less than referendum on joining the European Union. And now, from December 1st, in Croatian Constitution, we have paragraph 61st, which says marriage is a lifetime union of one woman and one man. And although they have no results in vital areas like rising production and GDP, in decreasing unemployment and immigration, or stopping the depopulation rates, the government still insists only on new law on registered partnership instead of same-sex marriage, so-called Vital Records Act, in which anyone can change their gender simply by signing a paper before a notary public, which is very liberal. Almost anybody can adopt a child or qualify for in vitro fertilization and on gender ideology. So, if all countries which recognize family values and traditional marriage don't act together, in the next 20 years we will experience more generations which will not care about family values, more divorced marriages, more dysfunctional families and unhappy individuals, new types of relationships which would demand to be recognized by law, and unhappy and unviable society. So we must support each other in preserving and empowering family values. Thank you for
Thank you very much, Mr. Jukotic. This has really been an incredible success story, very moving. We can all learn from the story, especially because you explained the historical background. We can see what a fight it was and is. And I think it inspires us to go a similar way. Now, next of our speaker will be Mrs. Yoshihawa. Yoshi is American, Hawa is a German name, so she has a German husband and 3 sons. She is currently the Marriage and Family Program Specialist for the U.S. Department of Health. Sorry, this was your time. For the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services Administration for Children and Families in New England. Yoshi earned a bachelor's degree in philosophy from Boston University in 1995, a master's degree in religion and secondary education from the Harvard Divinity School. We are very happy to welcome you here in Geneva.
Oh, thank you. I'm very happy to be here. Thrilled, actually, to be here. And I have to do a disclaimer because I'm here officially as a private citizen. To get permission from my government to come here, I have to jump through hoops and tell you lots of public information, but my personal comments about it will be my personal comments, not representative of my agency. So I'm here, I was hired by the Administration for Children and Families, which is in America the human services part of the US Department of Health and Human Services. So the Department of Health part is the huge budget, right? Medicare, Medicaid, Obamacare, or you know, the Affordable Care Act, all these health issues. So the human service side, for those who don't know how, in the, on the federal level, are social service programs, programs that help vulnerable families and children, and programs such as temporary assistance for needy families, which is welfare, child welfare, the Office of Community Services, the Office of Child Support Enforcement, the Office of Refugee Resettlement, Head Start programs. And so there are many different program offices under ACF. And let me just give you a little history, because I really want to talk about our Healthy Marriage and Responsible Fatherhood Initiative, which started, its roots are back actually under President Clinton in 2002. So in 2002, there was something called the Welfare Reform Act in America, and that was under President Clinton. And this was in America, child or single parenting is directly related to poverty, right? So in our social structure, you know, we're always trying to help women and children in poverty. So, but what was one thread contributing to that is lifetime benefits assistance, right? So you could get cash assistance if you were poor and beyond cash assistance for a lifetime, and therefore you created generations of people relying on government assistance. So actually under President Clinton, they did the Welfare Reform Act, and they said, okay, maximum is 5 years. And there was a lot of things that were rolled into that piece of legislation, because it was a sort of Republican-dominated Congress. But one piece of that was, and you can use part of your, states can use part of their money to do marriage promotion and marriage strengthening activities and fatherhood strengthening activities. Now, at that time, most states ignored that part, and they said, okay, we would rather put our money toward, you know, child care and stuff like that. But they did start responsible fatherhood work. So responsible fatherhood work was you could say, we have the Office of Child Support Enforcement, and the Child Support Enforcement Agency is interested in particularly getting dads to pay for their kids, especially if the moms are using public assistance. So it was really, up until 2002, they were using, you know, maybe this doesn't translate well, carrots and sticks. So to get child support, they were using mostly sticks, right? We're going to garnish your wages, and eventually we're going to throw you in jail if you don't pay your child support. So the responsible fatherhood movement in America started out as the carrot, you could say, or the, if you go to a fatherhood program, maybe you get some adjustment on what you owe. Plus, we can teach you why it's beneficial for you to be involved as a father in the life of your children. And these programs spread very quickly. President Clinton supported them a lot, and that was, it really helped. It showed that it helped men become involved with their children, whether they were living with a mom or not. And there was some evidence suggesting that they also, you know, were more apt to pay child support. So on the foundation of that, under President Bush, they sort of started the Healthy Marriage and Responsible Fatherhood Initiative. And this was a very controversial initiative when it first came out because of the word marriage. But because it was sort of brought in alongside fatherhood work, there was sort of some groundwork done. So that's about, the Healthy Marriage Initiative started out with small bits of funding administered through various ACF program offices. So the Office of Child Support Enforcement gave money to its sort of network to do marriage promotion activities. And these in America come out through demonstration competitive grant funding. So we had lots and lots of small grant projects, okay? And then in 2003, when welfare was reformed again, welfare in our country is reformed every 5 or 6 years, usually takes longer, they allowed $150 million to go for marriage and fatherhood strengthening activities. And so that was from roughly 2003 to 2008. And that was $100 million for marriage and $50 million for fatherhood activities. And these were testing different models of marriage strengthening programs, largely targeted at vulnerable families, low-income populations, but we sort of made it sure that there was a wide diversity of programming so we could test models of what works. Because you want to test something before you take it to scale. Or the idea was, eventually, if we could show that these marriage strengthening or and relationship strengthening programs actually helped couples stay together, or maybe helped couples who had a baby and they were poor think about marriage, understand a little bit more about marriage, how to have good communication skills, that that eventually state governments would then sort of take a little bit of their state block grant money and fund these themselves, sort of be off and running. That really hasn't happened yet, only a few states sort of bought into that. But we did accomplish, I think, a great number of things, and one of the things which I want to focus on, because I know I have just a few minutes, I could talk a long time. I was hired in 2004 as a specialist to kind of, there were 10 of us hired across the country, so that we could oversee these demonstration projects along with the project officers and the accountants and all the, you know, bean counters, to make sure that they were being implemented well and to provide technical assistance. So we received lots of training from great marriage experts in America, and we developed some incredible resources that I want to sort of focus on in this presentation, and then tomorrow's presentation I'll talk about some strategies for the future in case there are other governments interested in doing this kind of thing. Because this is more like, how can we help people establish and form healthy relationships, and what can you do, and how many different ways can you do it? Up to that point in America, the marriage and relationship education field is kind of a cross between psychology and education. So we call it psychoeducation, mostly group-based programs, not therapy, you know, one-on-one counseling, but a lot of skill-based programs. So not really great for couples in very, very high conflict. So we screened out domestic violence, and we made sure that every grantee was educated in domestic violence and to recognize the signs of it and to make partnerships with domestic violence, coalitions on the community level. We had many, many stipulations we had them do to ensure the safety of couples. So we had to sort of get folks to understand this is the broad market, and there's a wide diversity within that market audience. I won't say to market because they're not paying for it, but be creative, and we had certain elements, certain required hours, and sort of we required three components that they somehow teach about the benefits of marriage, that they offer communication skill training and conflict resolution, because research suggested that those truly helped. So it was a combination. Whatever curricula they used, whatever program model they used, the grantees, they sort of had to have those components to it. And we made sure of that, and we helped people who never thought in their agency that they could talk about the M word, the marriage word, become comfortable with it. And this was some of the most gratifying work that I've done, is to go into an agency that was serving men coming out of prison, helping them get their life back together. And the social worker, 30-year a 30-year social worker woman, said, "Oh no, we can never sell this. This will never go. My staff will just, reject it." She really thought that nobody would want to come to the program. But actually, her staff reviewed the curricula, which was developed by the Alabama Department of Social Services, and it was culturally sensitive. It used a lot of African proverbs, actually, and it's publicly available and it's free. And it's great curricula, and her staff loved it. And guess what? Lots of couples came to the program, and they did it again, and they did it again, and then word of mouth traveled. So I saw this kind of phenomena happen over and over again. Another example: we gave through our child welfare agency, the child welfare agencies in Vermont to provide retreats for parents who've adopted from the foster care system. And as I attended these retreats and gave sort of some advice on how to do it better, blah, 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 I was thinking, you know, we give Purple Hearts to veterans, you know, to people who are on the front line of defending our country. But here are people taking in children who are practically unwanted, right? They're taking in children who are already in the foster care system. They're adopting them. And they're good couples, and they usually come in to that effort with a strong marriage. But that strains their marriage. So we were providing these retreats and these marriage support services, and I saw, you know, how relevant and how powerful the work was. Another example where I think the work was very powerful was in our Office of Refugee Resettlement. And I worked with many grantees. The Office of Refugee Resettlement, America takes in more refugees, 70 to 80,000 per year now. This year will be much more, but more than all the other countries combined. And we have a whole system and network of how to take care of refugees, and they get lots of services, employment services, health services for the first 3 months. And so in specific agencies, they said, okay, we're gonna take on couples, you know, we're gonna give marriage education skills. And of course, refugees are coming from oftentimes with trauma, oftentimes various cultures and diverse languages, sometimes coming with two or three wives, and they have to choose one wife when they're in America because this is our law. Coming from cultures where men and women don't look at each other in the eye, so our educators on the ground had to do a lot of adjusting. So from those efforts, we allow them to. We allow them to adjust curricula and develop all kinds of new forms of curricula in different languages. I was just sharing an example yesterday. There were Somali Bantu families, and this is very low literacy, people with very low literacy rates. And so, you know, most of our material in America, you have to learn to read, even if it's just a little worksheet that you do. You read things, right? Well, if you have some people who can't read, what do you do? And you have this government grant, and you know the bean counter saying, hey, how many people are coming through your program? Well, they developed like cartoons, picture book, right? And they chose a very technical communication skills program, and they made wonderful picture books, you know, with characters that looked like the people they were serving, and it was very creative. And so there are many, many stories like that about how program models were modified and to fit and to reach the particular population. So, I want to go quickly. I was going to talk about research, but we also developed many great online sort of data banks and resources for different people. So this is just my agency's website. I just wanted to show you that we have it, you know, front and center. Healthy marriage is important. Okay. So the first thing we developed was called the National Healthy Marriage Resource Center, which still exists. That was under the first five-year, $150 million. And you can research all kinds of things. If you're an educator, you can. There's fact sheets that may be helpful to you, like really nicely done fact sheets, total research-based. We have some great researchers in America. And university-based folks, so you can search things. If you want to do marriage and health, you can just put in marriage and health, and you're going to find lots of articles and nicely done presentations. We also have webinars, so let's say you want to train your people, you can listen to the webinars. So they're all loaded there. And also, if you're into research and policy, there's marriage facts, policy resources for policymakers, and the media. So. The first round actually emphasized a lot of community coalition building and media campaign type of programs besides skill building work. So we did test that model a lot. I have to rip through this, but there's a treasure trove of information at the National Healthy Marriage Resource Center. Also, under our agency, the Office of Planning, Research, and Evaluation, OPRE, for the research wonky people. This is where the big evaluation studies that we funded, you can find all the technical details of the gold standard randomized controlled studies and the smaller studies that have been done just do a search under the Office of Planning, Research, and Evaluation. Okay, so the second round of funding that came under President Obama changed things a little bit. Required some more family stability and economic and financial strengthening activities along with a marriage or fatherhood, and put money more into fatherhood and actually equally divided it, $75 million for fatherhood and $75 million for marriage. And actually, this initial grants were just extended in another year because they're doing really well. And so the idea here in this sort of website is to help the next stage of the initiative, okay, you could say, is not just really inspiring, but independent demonstration projects. The next step, and it'll take longer, is to get these type of services into the existing safety net or social service networks themselves. So this resource, and maybe it'll be particularly relevant to the American system, but you might find interesting ideas, because I don't know, each country has their own way of providing social services, or what we call safety net services. You can go down here, and there's some really interesting videos, but it's really about how you can integrate marriage into your existing structures. So that's the Healthy Marriage and Families.org. And one last one, if you have a young person, this is called twoofus.org. It's kind of a really hip site that we created just for couples, for regular people. If you're dating, exclusive, engaged, married, and parents, lots of interesting videos and information to help, you know, individuals find resources and tools to help themselves. And these are all funded by public monies. So I'll talk more later. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Howard. The good news is that you have more time tomorrow. And the inspiring news for us in Europe is 150 million for healthy marriages. What a good way to address our government in Germany and other countries. I only wondered why there was no money for motherhood, only fatherhood.
The argument there is most of our social systems were set up to serve women and
what?
Children. Most of Head Start, child welfare, child support, most of them predominantly serve women.
I see.
We were unbalanced. We had to include the men and now include the couples and include the family.
Yeah. Anyway, that's really very, very enlightening that the United States is really going in this direction. Yeah, now we come to our fourth speaker in this session. It is Mr. Walter Bahn. He's the director of the Institute for Trends Research in Austria, and especially centering on European development in the global context. I had the pleasure, while waiting for over an hour, to come into this wonderful United Nations area and building, to spend the time with you, and I didn't miss 1 minute. I could have waited longer because it was so exciting to speak with you in this time and to learn quickly many things. So I'm very inspired and happy to introduce to you Mr. Walter Bahn.
Great to be back here with friends of UPF. You won't forget where I'm from when I tell you Austria won the song contest. You all know Conchita Wurst? She won this all here. However, okay, we live in crazy times. Yesterday, I met this guy. When he saw the ring on my finger, he came to me and he said, "Oh, you're married?" I said, "Yes, I am." And he said, "I mean, traditional marriage, man, woman." I said, "Yes, I am, yes." But, however, it's no problem at all. My children, they got used to that pretty soon. I got 10 minutes. I have 10 points for you. So if you fall asleep, you always know where you are.
Yeah, you have to use.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay.
Wake up again. Okay. A brief overview of a global trends which massively influenced the development of families. How can family policy control the development of marriage and family, or better, can it control it at all? And if you go deeper into the matter, why are families so important at all? One thing first, there is enough data already. We've seen brilliant data in the morning. Thank you very much again. So we can answer your questions pretty well. Okay, let's go to some trends which have the power to turn the world upside down. And that's what I call them, megatrends. Number one, this is the rising populations worldwide. This is a global trend, you know. And at the same time, at the same time, we have falling birth rates worldwide. Trend number two. So how does that fit together? That's easy to explain. We never had as many potential mothers as now. So if those women get less babies per capita than sooner mothers, there will still be more babies. Birth rates actually fall worldwide. That means that applies to rich countries, that applies to poor countries, that applies to less and least developed countries. That's very interesting. In general, it's also independent of religious affiliation. We have, for example, birth rates far below the replacement level in Tunisia or Iran. However, there are interesting exceptions, and religion also correlates with high birth rates. So you see, population science is very interesting. The first two trends lead to a demographic change, which is most likely, in some countries, it has already led to a reduction of population. There we can also see an increasing lack of skilled workers. Therefore, governments try to push back mothers into the job as quickly as possible. However, this has never increased birth rates anywhere. Demographic change mostly comes with a delay because of trend number three, the aging of societies. We get older because medical care is getting better and better. Food supply also plays a role. Meanwhile, every third person in the world is overweight. In the West, it is 1 in 2, and 20% are obese. As trend number four, we have the globalization of the world economy. As a result of this, combined with industrialization, the distances between the places of work and the dwellings increase. In search of work, people move, and mostly they move in cities. And this leads to megatrend number five. This is the emergence of megacities. Just imagine, in 2040, 80% of the world's population will live in cities, mainly in one of those megacities with more than 10 million inhabitants. And wherever people move to cities, they have fewer children. And as a result of a growing distance from job to home, we further come to megatrend number six, and this is the disintegration of the extended family. The family with father, mother, and child or children is no longer capable of any actual family responsibilities, such as child care or the care of elderly or sick. Tasks that have been mastered within the family must now be delegated to external institutions, such as kindergartens or nursing homes. There's another trend that affects mainly women, and this is growing economic independence of women. You know, it's the women who give birth to children. We can also say that the future is female, just because of this one single reason. May sound ridiculous, but it isn't. You know, actually, this is about the reconciliation of work and family. This has always been one of the biggest challenges for modern family policy. And the point is, better a woman is educated, the later she marries, the later she gets children, and the fewer children she has. This is a global trend. Trend number 8, growing individualism. A growing economic independence of both men and women leads to an increase in privacy among family members. This is one of the bases of a new individualism. We see a shift in partnership from marriage as an economic partnership to companionship and emotional satisfaction. No doubt. These all are positive things, but we have to consider what that means to a society. In more and more societies worldwide, this development led to an awful competition. Individualism on one hand versus community spirit on the other hand. A game that doesn't know any winner. We have fewer marriages, we heard about that. We have more divorces worldwide. The social acceptance of divorces rises. This again is a global trend, also in Islamic countries. 87% of the world population, you see here in the graph, live in countries with marriage rates that have fallen since the 1980s. At the same time, divorce rates rise. However, high divorce rates do not inevitably mean that all those people live on their own. We also heard that in the morning. You may be a little bit confused now, but I can tell you, in fact, most children still are born in stable relations. Trend number 9, a systematic devaluation of family. Big question is, how do we define family? We suffer from an inflationary use of the term family. You know that. To say it clear, family is not just simply where two people live together or where somebody lives with children. It's not enough. And we have a bad discrimination against families. Who discriminates against families? The reason is very interesting. We support single mothers and fathers so strong that it doesn't make any sense anymore to marry from the economical point of view. Mm-hmm. In many cases, it doesn't even make sense to work as a single mother. No wonder that the number doesn't go back, but rises. The deep problem behind it is that those subsidies come from the taxpayers. However, this is no coincidence, but sometimes that's called political calculation. Politicians create dependencies and want votes for the benefits. We also call that vote buying, and that reminds me of Anson Rome. And then I have as point number 10, sustainability. We have heard about that when it comes to nature. For societies, it's just the same. For a good harvest, you have to sow before. But if other things were impermanent, family came back again and again. In Europe, there's a tendency to see children as a way to keep the pay-as-you-go system running. That's a bad mistake. Children are more than a number in a calculation. Besides, 75% of Europe's elderly care takes place within the family. The indebted welfare states could simply not afford more care outside the family. They couldn't simply afford it. Remember, all that against the background of an aging society. Mm-hmm. This underlines the importance of family. But we have to make it clear that the society has no future without children. The family has always been the core of society. That has been proven for thousands of years. There's no other way. So be strong in your effort for the family. Thank you very much.
I think I did not promise too much in the beginning when I said this is going to be an exciting session. And Mr. Barr, I believe you gave us an amazing overview about the mega trends, which are quite easy to remember. Thank you very much. And it makes really sense where our world is heading, especially also why family is definitely needs to be protected. So we still have a few minutes time for question and answers. So I open the floor. To my knowledge, we have till 4:15.
Four thirty.
Don't we have a break? Oh yeah, we have really time this time. So please, Mr. Benson.
Cesar, thank you very much indeed. I'm just wondering whether Josie Harris, comes all the way over from the States, the Americans have the most advanced research programs in the family in the world. And I suspect, if I'm right, that Josie told us a tiny fraction of what she might like to have told us about the research programs. And I'm wondering if there's any chance that we could submit a referendum, taking my lead from Mr. we could submit a referendum for an extra 10 minutes from Josie on the research findings.
You should use the microphone. Sorry for the translator. Okay.
We understood it. I don't know if we need a referendum. We'll give you definitely some time for that.
Right tomorrow.
Tomorrow she's also going to speak. Shall we give you immediately the floor or maybe have one?
I think maybe good now. Yeah?
To give it now.
Okay. Yeah, give you, take a, because we have half an hour.
Yeah, okay, 10 minutes. We have half an hour. It's amazing. So.
So we've done a lot of research.
Also, there's been private research done. The Urban Institute, how does government do research? Well, we contract with the Urban Institute, RTI, MDRC. Like I said, our office of, where was it? Office of Planning, Research, and Evaluation. You can find it there, or if you search marriage journals, if you have databases, you can find lots and lots of studies on topics like marriage and health, and does marriage education work, and does it work for poor couples, and does it work for black families? And so we have served so many diverse groups. Maybe that's also one of the strengths of America, is we are testing different models. And what works better? How many hours of dosage work? And what are really good recruitment strategies? So it's all there if you want it. You can jump into it. Now, our gold level, which we were really, in the first round, sort of hoping, we funded two big evaluation studies, well, actually three, the Strengthening Healthy Families study, Supporting Healthy Marriages, SHM, BSF, and something called the Community Healthy Marriage Initiative Evaluation. And these are gold level standard, you know, randomized controlled studies, which took years to implement and years to analyze the data. These type of studies, again, look for effects across programs. So even if there's different models or different, in the first round, there were different models and different dosages, and they tested different models. But they were looking at anywhere from personal impacts on the couple, did it produce any, you know, marriages, was there greater awareness in the community, and many, many psychological variables. So you can find the details of these studies online. The big controlled studies didn't actually produce this the effects we would have liked to have seen, you know, writ large. So they did suggest, however, a few very important things. One is there were some small sustained effects on many psychological variables, like marital happiness, program satisfaction, and these were measured at the time of the program's completion, 12 months later, and 30 months later. So that's a very expensive evaluation. And to do that with thousands of participants all across the nation. So the data was crunched in these broad ways, and it found some small program effects. And the discussion of findings, again, we have to always understand it's implementation makes a huge difference. So when we broke the data down into which programs actually had the bigger program effects, you could see that there were more robust effects in certain certain programs or certain grantees. So a couple of our grantees were state-level grantees, so there was a state-based or a very multi-community-based initiative, one in Oklahoma, in California, and First Things First in Tennessee, and this is where they really sort of saturated the community with, these are marriage programming services, this is where you can find them, and a lot of, you know, media outreach using different curriculum models, and there you saw that there were better program effects when programs were more fully implemented and when they had greater infrastructure and where there were wraparound services that were truly tailored to the marriage education population and services. So how you do marriage strengthening work in the community really, really matters. It really matters. And so it's become somewhat more of a science, you know. Certainly the whole field has been pushed forward, and very recently the Office of Planning, Research and Evaluation asked for more research for the data to be reanalyzed to look at more specific detail on really where the programs made effects and on what populations and under what conditions. So we're going to be generating more knowledge as that big data set gets crunched again and again. So again, you know, the sad news, well, I mean, you know, the opponents of marriage made a big deal of it. You didn't find the program effects you were looking for, the big ones, you know. But we said, okay, but there was a lot of good news in the reports that universally people say they appreciate the services, universally. And another fact which is interesting is that couples with who are coming into programs with sort of low conflict, they didn't have such a great change. So, but couples coming into the program with more higher conflict, they showed greater change, positive change. So then you have to ask yourself, you know, the question, where do we get the most bang for the buck if you can convince some public entity to put some money behind some marriage strengthening work? Then maybe you can look to the American data as it comes out and look through it yourself and say, aha, there were greatest effects when we served this type of person, these type of couples in this type of way. The youth prevention programs also showed effects, and many, many smaller research studies showed more programmatic effects. Studies where men coming from prison were given marriage and relationship skilled programs reported greater adjustment in the community 6 months afterwards. So there's a lot of detail in the research, and I think it's if you are serious about sort of promoting this in a science with good science behind you, in your respective regions or countries, please do access our databases, or you can always contact me, and I can help you find some information. So I'm sure UPF will have my contact information. You can contact me, and I can help you wade through the research or the curricula. We may have already developed curricula in a language that's in a population you're serving. We have curricula in Spanish, curricula in Bhutanese, in Vietnamese, in Chinese. Yeah, many documents are translated, and these are available. And so do not hesitate to contact me, and I will, if I don't know the answer, I can probably find the expert in America or somebody who knows somebody to get you assistance. And also, just one more thing. Okay, so again, if you're talking to policymakers in a certain social service network, this particular set of website, I think, is very helpful. Because the Resource Center offers training and service and support to those who really want to put it into their social safety networks. Because that's more like on the implementation side, onto existing services. So, you know, in our first round of funding, we did a lot of individual programs. You could have been a faith-based program, a community-based program. But this website is really focused on for integration into existing social service networks, which I think is extremely important if you want to change the conversation and put marriage back on the table. Yes, I think Thank you so much for giving me a Jewish tradition.
But first, you in the back. You were before.
I feel America is so schizophrenic. You hear Obama speaking about responsible fatherhood and the problems of single-parent families, and then with the Attorney General, they're pushing gay marriage and all that. I just feel totally schizophrenic when I hear to both sides of the story. Can you explain?
Good question.
It's a good question. I'm not sure I can fully explain. The Defense of Marriage Act was signed under Bill Clinton, and that defined marriage as a union between one man and one woman. That was recently overturned by our Supreme Court because of a strong lobby through the states and through various groups. How it will affect the work of our marriage and fatherhood work, probably not so much, because our agency is focused on helping poor and vulnerable families with children, which are largely not the gay men and women who are getting married. They're not poor, generally speaking. So I'm just saying, I don't know how it will affect my work in the future, except I do know that, you know, in the past, there are special curricula for gay couples, and our grantees couldn't use that curricula. Probably in the next round of funding, they can serve openly and actively serve gay couples. That's how it will possibly affect our work. It's schizophrenic policy. It could be. I mean, I can't really comment to that, except that Bill Doherty? The Institute for American Values. They did a big shift from being very pro-traditional family to being more like, okay, we want to promote families, so let's open it up. There's arguments, we argued about it, I mean, not me personally, but there have been argued about it in scholars, whether saying marriage is for everybody, marriage is good for everybody, for gay people, for straight people, that will actually help the marriage agenda. So you can look at those arguments. I'm not going to convince you one way or the other, because I really can't comment on it. That's more like a political policy issue. I can sort of speak in private about it, but I know that there are people who actually think, you know, if we just push marriage for everybody, that it'll help with the marriage promotion activities overall.
Maybe you will have some private meeting afterwards. Steve.
Turn it on. Microphone.
Jersey.
Yeah. Okay. You mentioned some of the best successes with the youth. Could you just explain a little bit, like what that meant?
Well,
I have two questions.
Okay. The youth prevention. I mean, we microphone. Define marriage education very broadly.
Microphone.
In the allowable activities under the grant funding, we defined marriage and relationship education very broadly, from premarital education, relationship skills training that always had to sort of include some content about the benefits of marriage, including like the health benefits and the psychological benefits and the economic benefits. That those programs were extremely well received. Getting them into schools or youth centers or churches is always the challenge, you know, to have sustainable programs. But those showed some very, very good results in terms of changing young people's understanding and of marriage itself. Just raw knowledge about what is marriage and the benefits of marriage, especially the financial aspect. You know, the asset building aspect of marriage, that idea appeals to young people, right? And nobody ever introduced that idea to them. You know, because they have this notion of, I got to have all my ducks in my row financially before I can marry or not marry, or marriage will drain my wallet or whatever. But, you know, over time, they just don't understand that the trend over a lifetime, technically, you know, is that married people who stay together, they build assets together. So those type of programs showed shifts in understanding of marriage.
Good. I have a question and any. How are two more questions? Okay, these to you and then.
Yeah, my question is for Dr. Barr. I mean, the situation in Austria is you have mainly, we have a very predominant Catholic Church that is, of course, certainly influencing family policy. But when I hear, for instance, this incredibly massive support for, I mean, it's probably massive for us Europeans to hear such kind of massive family and marriage support programs in the US. Do you see, is there something similar, if not from the state side in Austria, or is there something maybe more from the Catholic Church side?
Thank you for the question. Yeah. Our first interesting point, religion. The more religious you are, the more children you have. There's a correlation, okay? But don't forget, you have countries like Iran, yeah? Islamic Republic of Iran, where you have birth rate of 1.7, far below the replacement level. They would ruin all the country if they would propagate an Islam where you have as many children as possible. This plays also a major role in Egypt. Yeah? People have too many children. Roman Catholic Church, of course, yeah, the church plays a role, but it has to find its modern way. I mean, it's about what you can offer the next generation. Yeah, it's not good to have too many children. If you look at Africa, it's not good to have not enough children. So you have to find a balance.
Okay, but in terms of finance, the Catholic Church will put money into such programs?
I think those times are over. The programs are decreasing. Yeah.
It's decreasing.
It's history. Yeah. The Roman Catholic Church actually doesn't play such a big role anymore.
In Austria?
Not only in Austria. Yeah. Remember, this is history. Yeah, the church has to find its new role. Yeah, they have to find new role models. Yeah.
Good. Any questions?
Yes. Mine is not a question, but I want to contribute something. I'm Swiss and I speak for Switzerland. And this morning we. Talked about how can laws and government influence the marriage. In Switzerland, we get punished in three generations if we are married. So I make three small examples. I am living with my family in a quite remote place, and when we want to send our children to academic studies, they have to move out from home. And my son asked for governmental help, but he couldn't get any because we are an average middle class family. But he found out that if we were divorced or single parents, he would immediately get help. So this is against marriage. The second stage is our generation. People who never got married and have a certain wealth, they pay much less taxes. Because in Switzerland, taxable income of husband and wife is accumulated, and if you get a higher income, the tax percentage is getting high. So it is not worthy to get married for tax reasons. And the third punishment is old people. If you have a certain wealth and accumulate because you have a house and saved all life long, if one of the couple has to go into old people's residence, then you have first to spend all the savings you made in your life till you have nothing, and then the social welfare starts. But if you always spend all the money, the social welfare starts immediately. So in one situation, I know a couple where the wife got a chronic disease, and they see in advance already that by next 20 years she should be recovered or something. And they went to a financial consultant, and she told them, well, one option would be to divorce. So your wealth gets split up 50 and 50, and you risk only to lose half of it. This is the third punishment. So we have a lot to do, even in rich Switzerland.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, then I give you the last chance.
Walter, I saw you were reading the cards from the past, and I wonder if you could read some cards from the future. Can you look in your crystal ball and see what the world will be like if you look at the trends that you were looking at? And if you look at those, is there something that you say, we need to really watch this or that particular item?
Thank you again for the question. Yesterday is absolutely. Heard it from Mr. Kane and Mr. Benz in the morning. That was very interesting. Thank you for your presentation. I think it would make sense to invest much more in marriage. Why? If you compare, for example, the birth rate in Ireland, you know, where the state doesn't hardly any do anything for families, and you take birth rates of, just say, Czech Republic, Austria, Germany, and all those other European states where we have an average of 1.5 children per woman, you have hardly any difference. So why do they do that? Yeah, doesn't make sense. Talk about that. That's what we are gonna watch. Yeah, we have to come back to a point where we do things that make sense. Yeah, and family, actually, family makes sense. We need a balance between, on one hand, those people who pay into the system, on the other hand, people who get something from the system. If you lose the balance here, the system crashes. We saw already some crashes. We don't have to invent something. Yeah? Just turn time back to, say, 1993. The Swedish pension system was bankrupt. Yeah? So what did the Swedish people, the government do personally? He simply cut pensions down to 60%. Yeah? And six weeks later, there was an election, and the voters they gave him Pearson their votes, because then he could say, "Okay, people, there's no other choice. That's what we gotta do." I believe that we could do something sooner, before the system crashes.
Maybe that is.
I know we can go on. I think this was a very, very interesting last thought. Maybe to sum it up, family seems to be the gateway to happiness in heaven, but as a psychologist says, it's also the birthplace of most of our neurosis. So we are challenged to make happy families, and so maybe policies from where we go now should be how we can really make happy marriages and families. Thank you very much, and have a nice break. We'll come back at 4:45. Thank you.
So, yeah, thank you very much. I know that it's nice to have a talk and chat. coffee. So we will start our next panel. This is about the unique contribution of civil society, NGOs, and faith-based organizations in transcending marriage and family in the 21st century. So I present myself first. My name is Brigitte Wada. I am president of the Women Federation in France and also vice president of the Women Federation in Europe. So I'm very happy to be able to lead these panels with very nice people, I think. It will be very interesting panels. So I may start to speak in French just to present the first speaker. Then he will feel himself at home in French. That's what he said to me. So, qui va parler, c'est Monsieur Hafid Wardiri. Il est Monsieur Hafid Wardiri est un des fondateurs de la Grande Mosquée de Genève. Il est aussi le porte-parole pendant 30 ans. Et puis aussi, il est le président fondation de l'entreconnaissance à Genève. Donc, Monsieur Wardiri fait aussi le ramadan. Donc, je voulais aussi le mentionner. Il jeûne. Donc, voilà, il va nous introduire à son thème. C'est pour vous.
Merci, Madame la Présidente. Merci. Salam alaikum, que la paix de Dieu soit avec vous. Je cherchais l'introduction, puis je ne trouve pas mieux comme introduction. Et merci donc aux organisateurs de m'avoir demandé de venir parler de la famille. Je pense que nous sommes tous capables de parler de la famille, étant donné que nous sommes tous issus d'une famille et nous avons aussi mis en place une famille. Donc je pense que chacun d'entre nous est capable d'en parler. Je ne crois pas qu'il faille être un génie ni un expert pour dire qu'aujourd'hui la famille va mal et l'économie aussi. Ce qui fait que nous sommes face à deux grands défis. C'est comment faire en sorte pour que la famille puisse retrouver son sens, comment faire que l'économie cesse de dicter les lois et cesse de faire de nous que de la chair à économie. J'ai écouté certaines des interventions et je me rends compte en définitive que nous sommes capables aujourd'hui simplement de comprendre comment les choses se sont faites pour que l'on se trouve dans cette situation. On peut faire des expertises extraordinaires pour dire comment on en est là. Mais ce qui serait intéressant, c'est de faire en sorte que, après le constat de la situation que nous vivons, nous puissions éventuellement reprendre les valeurs éducatives qui nous ont appris comment être capables de créer une famille et de vivre en cette famille de manière heureuse et de tirer le maximum de ce que cette famille peut nous apporter de positif et ne pas simplement la condamner pour ce qui ne va pas. Alors, en tant que musulman, je dois vous dire que la question de la famille n'est pas laissée au tâtonnement de l'être humain. Il y a, bien entendu, des textes clairs, tant dans le Coran que dans la tradition prophétique, pour nous apprendre qu'est-ce que c'est que la famille, quelle importance elle a. Et bien sûr, la famille commence par le rapport que peut avoir un homme et une femme dans l'affection qu'ils doivent nourrir les uns aux autres, dans l'amour qu'ils doivent se porter, dans la patience qu'ils doivent avoir à vivre ensemble et dans la manière de savoir conjuguer « nous » alors qu'avant ils conjuguaient « je ». Comment conjuguer avec la personne au pluriel « nous » et arrêter de dire « je » et l'autre aussi dit « je ». Ils doivent tous les deux utiliser le « je » mais ensemble ils doivent savoir conjuguer « nous ». Donc la famille est absolument... Selon la tradition de l'islam, la famille est absolument essentielle parce qu'elle est celle qui va, d'une part, permettre à l'humanité de se régénérer et d'autre part, dans la tradition de l'islam, la famille est le lieu où l'on où l'on trouve tout ce qui est nécessaire pour pouvoir répondre aux situations difficiles qui pourraient apparaître à cause de circonstances particulières. Je dois là saluer, parce que je risquerais de l'oublier, cette charmante dame suisse qui a parlé des trois punitions que nous subissons ici en Suisse. Et je soutiens tout à fait ce qu'elle a dit, parce qu'en effet, tout est fait pour que la famille n'existe pas. Ou bien elle existe, mais malheureuse, mais pas heureuse. C'est-à-dire que tout est là pour faire en sorte que les gens qui vivent en famille finissent par penser que la famille est nocive pour eux et que la meilleure manière, c'est de la disloquer et de vivre chacun pour soi. Comme cela nous coûtera moins cher. C'est une erreur de calcul parce que ça coûte horriblement cher. Ne serait-ce que quand on voit, par exemple, ce que les services sociaux dépensent pour compenser les problèmes que cela pose aux individus lorsqu'ils n'ont pas cette structure familiale qui leur permet de pouvoir faire face aux conditions de la vie, surtout quand cette vie devient de plus en plus difficile. Alors, ce qui est important à savoir, c'est que on ne fonde pas une famille comme cela. La famille se fonde à partir de la valeur de chacun de ceux qui vont la fonder. Donc chacun, que ce soit la femme ou l'homme, parce que pour moi et pour l'islam que je respecte, il n'y a d'autre famille que cette famille-là. Il ne saurait y avoir d'autre famille que cette famille-là, quand bien même aujourd'hui la démocratie et le droit veulent nous faire accepter qu'il y a d'autres familles que celle-là. Donc, la famille, elle se compose de deux êtres au départ, et ces deux êtres-là doivent être conscients chacun de quel est le rôle qu'ils doivent mener l'un avec l'autre pour pouvoir donner naissance à d'autres enfants qui vont vivre d'une part dans l'affection, dans le partage, dans la solidarité, non seulement dans le cadre de leur famille, mais au-delà, dans le cadre des autres familles, par rapport à la famille à laquelle ils appartiennent et à la famille humaine aussi à laquelle ils appartiennent. Juste par mémoire pour ma chère mère qui nous a quittés il n'y a pas très longtemps, elle me disait toujours, tu sais mon fils, c'est l'affection que tu recevras dans ta famille qui te préservera des infections que la société est en train de te préparer. Donc, il est absolument important de savoir qu'une société saine ne peut se faire qu'à partir d'une famille saine. Mais aujourd'hui, on n'est plus dans ce cas de figure. Aujourd'hui, on essaye de réparer quelque chose qu'on a laissé se casser. Il y va de notre responsabilité. Nous n'avons pas à pleurer sur notre sort, mais les valeurs sont encore là. Dans toutes les religions, les valeurs sont là pour que ce noyau, qui est le noyau essentiel, évident de l'état de l'humanité, si ce noyau ne va pas, c'est tout l'état de l'humanité qui ne va. Donc, il y a certaines clés, comme par exemple le fait que Dieu nous dit qu'il nous a créés l'un pour l'autre pour que l'on puisse se reposer les uns avec les autres et que l'on puisse se porter affection, amour, compréhension. Il nous dit aussi que il ne faut pas choisir seulement d'épouser, par exemple, pour fonder une femme, qu'une femme parce qu'elle est belle ou parce qu'elle est riche, mais il est important de choisir plutôt la femme qui est éduquée et qui a des principes qui vont nous permettre de pouvoir construire quelque chose à long terme. Parce que si l'on choisit seulement la richesse ou la richesse peut à un moment disparaître, la beauté peut se faner, et à partir de là, lorsqu'on a eu ses choix, eh bien, on risque de se retrouver dans une situation de séparation, et là va fonctionner, bien entendu, le divorce et ainsi de suite. Donc, ce qui est important, c'est de pouvoir faire en sorte que ce que l'on va mettre en place comme foyer soit un foyer qui génère la sérénité, qui génère la joie, qui génère aussi la force nécessaire pour lutter contre les situations les plus difficiles. Il y a même un verset, et cela pourrait peut-être étonner ceux qui ne le connaissent pas, où il nous dit « Ne tuez jamais vos enfants par crainte de pauvreté. Nous, Dieu, assurerons votre nourriture et la leur. En effet, le fait de les tuer serait une grande faute impardonnable. » Aujourd'hui, on se rend compte par la pression de la pauvreté, de la précarité, de la fragilité, certains sont amenés à soit dire « j'en veux pas plus », soit éventuellement s'en débarrasser parce qu'ils estiment qu'ils ne pourront plus leur apporter ce que leur responsabilité doit leur apporter, et ainsi de suite. Donc nous ne devons pas fléchir devant des situations qui peuvent apparaître ça et là pour dire je ne serai pas capable de porter ma famille, et à ce moment-là, je me mets dans un état de faiblesse que n'importe qui peut instrumentaliser. Donc la famille doit rester le noyau le plus résistant à l'égard de toute politique, de toute adversité, de tout conflit. La famille doit être là, c'est celle qui va permettre à l'être humain de trouver le confort, le réconfort, et puis le refuge nécessaire, si c'est nécessaire. Il y a aussi un autre verset, par exemple, qui dit « N'obligez pas vos filles à la prostitution si elles cherchent la chasteté au détriment des biens terrestres. Et celui qui les obligera, Dieu sera miséricordieux envers elles. » Il arrive aussi que dans certaines circonstances, que l'on voit dans certains pays où la misère, pour ne pas dire la pauvreté, mais la misère, s'acharne sur ces populations, certains gens qui, malgré le fait qu'ils sont respectueux de leur dignité, qu'ils sont respectueux du lien familial, se sentent obligés, quelque part, d'une manière détournée, d'envoyer leurs enfants soit à des travaux qui sont absolument indignes, soit les filles à aller chercher quelques menus deniers pour pouvoir faire survivre la famille. Le Coran est là pour nous dire que quoi qu'il arrive, nous devons être respectueux de cette famille, parce que le meilleur pour sa famille, Dieu dit, est celui, le meilleur auprès de moi est celui qui est le meilleur pour sa famille. Donc nous ne sommes pas dans un état de tâtonnement. La famille, ce n'est pas quelque chose qui nous est inconnu et que subitement, on découvre que ça n'existe plus. Nous avons, malheureusement, par les choix que nous avons faits, nous avons œuvré pour que cette famille soit dans cette situation disloquée, délicate. Comme disait la dame, on n'a plus la possibilité de soutenir nos enfants pour leurs études, tout simplement parce que les moyens dont on dispose sont des moyens qui sont terriblement, horriblement, exagérément taxé, et alors à ce moment-là, la seule proposition qu'il nous reste, c'est de casser la famille pour qu'on puisse éventuellement vivre de la mendicité que l'État veut bien mettre à notre disposition. Sans trop prolonger, et peut-être qu'à travers les questions qui se poseront tout à l'heure, je pourrai répondre à certaines situations qui prévalent aujourd'hui dans nos pays et qui ne sont pas tout à fait à l'image de ce que l'islam nous enseigne, ni la tradition prophétique. Le fait est simplement, ce que je voulais dire à travers la perspective de l'islam, c'est qu'il y a des valeurs qui ont été enseignées à l'homme. C'est l'homme qui les a négligées. Et si aujourd'hui nous sommes dans cet état-là, c'est qu'on a favorisé la matière au lieu de favoriser l'esprit de l'être humain. Merci.
Monsieur Hafid Ouardiri, merci de nous avoir encore exprimé la valeur de la famille et l'importance de la famille en tant que noyau pour une bonne société saine. Donc voilà, nous allons passer à notre prochain intervenant. Maybe I may speak now in English, because, sorry. So I may now introduce in English. This is Mrs. Nancy Sontag, Lyon, yes. She is a representative of a Latter-day Saints charities in Geneva, a former state representative serving 3 terms in Utah House of Representatives, co-chairing the Higher Education Appropriation Subcommittee, Assistant VP for Government Affairs at University of Utah. So this is your turn.
Thank you so much. Am I on?
Yes.
Okay. It is a delight to be here. It is a delight to see so many like-minded people who value the family and whose hearts beat as ours do in honoring the family. We're honored, and I am honored to participate in this conference commemorating the 20th anniversary of the International Year of the Family. As a faith-based organization, you may wonder who we are and what do we see as our defining mission. Latter-day Saint Charities is the humanitarian arm of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, the Mormons. And it has a very unique support structure. And because of this, LDS Charities has access to the resources of our church, which include food production and processing, donated used clothing, employment and social services, and the ability to purchase goods locally in many parts of the world. We sponsor relief and development projects in 179 countries. Assistance is rendered without regard to race, religious affiliation, or nationality, and it's based on the core principles of personal responsibility, community support, self-reliance, and sustainability. It is largely run with volunteer labor, operating both independently and in cooperation with other charitable organizations and governments. More than 1 million man days of labor are contributed yearly by volunteers in support of these initiatives. LDS Charities provides emergency relief assistance in times of natural disasters. In addition, our primary community development programs include clean water, neonatal resuscitation, training, vision care, wheelchairs, immunizations, food production, and other health programs. And as a faith-based NGO in consultative status with ECOSOC, our focus is humanitarian relief and refugees and development on the one hand, and on the other hand, our focus is on human rights, particularly freedom of religion or belief and the family. And why do we do these things? LDS Charities is literally an application of the admonition of Jesus Christ to help others in need. We believe that each of us are brothers and sisters, and reaching out with helping hands to those in need is putting our faith in action. Like other faith-based organizations that focus on service to others, it allows for opportunities to assist where it otherwise may be difficult or to be accepted or even to be allowed into a country. We are here today to celebrate the family. Let me share with you some very wise words expressed by a former president of our church, David O. McKay, who said, "No other success can compensate for failure in the home." Powerful and profound counsel for parents and for policymakers alike. In our work at the United Nations, my husband Joseph and I are guided by three foundational principles that are core beliefs of our church. Indeed, you could call these our three pillars: faith, family, and freedom. These three pillars guide us as individuals, as members of our church, and we believe they are the recipe for positive growth, change, and development throughout the world. They are inextricably woven, connected, sustaining and strengthening each other. When one of them is struck, the other two are damaged. Professor Amy Wax, who is a professor at the University of Pennsylvania Law School, wrote that the decreasing commitment to traditional marriage and the declining birth rates that go along with that, pose, and I quote, "an urgent and unavoidable challenge both to our continuation as a society and to our very conception of the worth of human existence." She asked, "Is the demographic implosion a response to practical costs and benefits, or does it tell us something deeper about a loss of purpose or faith?" End of quote. We do live in challenging times. Faith is waning, as has been mentioned, and under attack.
family as we have known it for millennia is under attack. Freedom is challenged and under attack. We are witnessing in much of the developing world a cultural shift that characterized a shift characterized by less and less affiliation with organized or institutional religion. If faith declines, are there societal consequences or repercussions? How does this waning religiosity impact families and society? Should we be concerned? What is the significance of marriage and the family to the economy? In his report, The Rise of Post-Familialism, Joel Kotkin noted that one of the commonalities between all of the major religions is that they elevate family and kinship to a central place in human existence. Secularism tends toward agnosticism about the family. This distinction has real world consequences. Take any cohort, and in his case, he's looking at Americans, but I think you could apply it literally anywhere. Take any cohort by race, income, education, and sort them by religious belief. The more devout they are, the higher their rates of marriage, and the more children they have. Patrick Fagan, who is a senior fellow and director of Marriage and Religion Research Institute at the Family Research Council, made this observation about the impact of families on the American economy. No matter which way you look at it, through the lens of income, savings, or poverty, marriage is the great engine of the economy, with every household a building block that either contributes or takes away, millions of times over. Put all those families together and we have the team that runs the American economy. But the family as economic driver goes far beyond an American phenomenon. In 1996, the Pontifical Council for the Family brought together 60 experts on economic and social questions, including Nobel laureates, for an international meeting on the family and economy of the, in the future of society. This august body asserted that, and I quote, every person represents the creative potential, which is the real wealth of nations, human capital, and recognize that it is the greatest resource for the for a healthy economy. The foundation of human capital is strong family life. Family is both the producer of human capital and its first investor. Above all, the family transmits values and virtues, creating human capital in the true sense. Men and women who are willing to give of themselves, to make commitments, to trust others, and to cooperate with them. Without this ethical social basis, a strong economy cannot develop or be sustained. The family is thus the key to a healthy society and its economy. If the family flourishes, society will be sound, but this is a reciprocal process. The family cannot survive without a good economy, and society cannot survive without good families. Have things changed since 1996? In many ways. Should we be making different policy decisions about the family and marriage? More recently, in May of this year, Pope Francis spoke to a gathering of the UN System Chief Executives Board for Coordination, including Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, where he counseled that future sustainable development goals must be formulated and carried out with generosity and courage so that they can have a real impact on poverty and hunger, protect the environment, and provide appropriate protection for the family, which is an essential element in sustainable human and social development. As we see the political and cultural pressures bearing down on marriage and by association on the family,
it is easy to feel discouraged about the future prospects of mankind. Michael Novak, an American Catholic philosopher, journalist, and diplomat, wrote nearly 40 years ago that clearly the family is the seedbed of economic skills. Even when poverty and disorientation strike, it is the family strength that most defends individuals against alienation or despair. One unforgettable law that has been learned painfully through all the oppressions, disasters, and injustices of the last 1,000 years, if things go well with the family, life is worth living. When the family falters, life falls apart. Joe and I have been married for 42 years. We are the parents of 4 daughters and 1 son. They are now married and starting their own families. We have 9 grandchildren. Was it easy? Or should I say, is it easy? It still is in the present tense. Is it easy? No. Is it worth it? Yes. But we have learned that our family work continues, and our rising generation is still part of our work. And that is the big question, isn't it, for the diversity of marriage relationships that exist in the world today. Will there be rising generations? Many years ago, a tornado touched down in Florida, in the U.S. One woman living in a mobile home went into her bathroom for safety. The mobile home began to shake violently. A few moments passed, and things subsided, and then she heard her neighbor's voice. "I am here in the front room." Coming out of the bathroom, to her great astonishment, she discovered that the tornado had picked up her mobile home and carried it through the air, landing it perfectly upright on the top of her neighbor's mobile home. I share this episode as an example of what is literally happening in our time. Social norms and lives are being shaken, disrupted, and challenged in many ways. These are wonderful times that we live in, but some would say, as Thomas Paine, one of the American revolutionary leaders, these are the times that try men's, and I would say, and women's souls. For our families and for one another, let us be the reassuring voice and comforting voice they hear saying, "I am here." A powerful yet simple formula for strengthening the nations of the world: faith, family, freedom. I conclude by repeating the words of wisdom of David O. McKay: no success can compensate for failure in the home. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Sontag-Lyon, for this, to remind us these 3 pillars: faith, and families, and freedom. So now we come to the next speaker. This is Mr. Joseph Misseton. Yes, Joseph Misseton. He is a consultant for business, NGO, and psychotherapist. He is also married, of course, and he has 3 children. Yes. And he's a spokesman on ethics and family affairs, NGO, Hermetic International. That's right. So this is your time.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for the invitation to this important event. The location of the United Nations, a place of hope and opportunity, set within the beauty of Switzerland. The title of my speech is Communication of Values, a Chance for Civil Society, NGOs, and Faith-Based Organizations in Strengthening Personality, Family, and Nations. Values influence behavior, whether we like it or not. Let's envision a society that progresses forward by promoting personal development, mutual cooperation, and meaningful living. Here it is important to distinguish between living happily and living meaningfully. Those who experience meaning in life approach and master life's challenges with a positive attitude. A person discovers meaning through relationships and experiences that go beyond the level of the individual. The great Austrian doctor, psychologist, and psychotherapist Viktor Frankl adopted the search for meaning as the primary focus of his work. Dr. Frankl, a man who himself experienced extreme challenges and suffering in the concentration camp, concluded that it was each person's duty to give an answer to the questions of life. The questions are unique to each person, however, there are some similarities that are common to all people. As such, in our pursuit of meaning, we will always be confronted with the issue of transcendence, that which goes beyond the limits of our own individual beings, an experience that leads us to several major questions. Where do we come from? Where are we going? What is our mission in life? What's our calling? What's our job? What do we human beings all have in common? On the one hand, we are creatures of self-determination, or as biologist Umberto Maturana put it, are autopoietic. That is to say that a person can't be compelled in any direction from the outside. Through your will and belief, we shape our lives surrounded by nature and an ever-expanding universe, a form of higher energy with which we interact. So we are the creators of our own life. We also interact with other people, and our actions as individuals impact our environment. That can be observed quite clearly if we look within our own family. If we are inwardly calm, clear, and friendly, that mindset impacts our environment rather quickly. We do not feel stressed by squabbling children, nor do we allow ourselves to be burdened by the misfortunes of our partners. When we remain in such a frame of mind, we remain a source of goodness. Conversely, if we're in a bad mood, tense, restless, or not at peace with ourselves, or if we feel alone and frightened, we produce exactly the same negative effect on the outside. The inside matches the outside. If we wish to change the world, then we must first change ourselves. A truth that human race has known for thousands of years. But how can we do that? What allows us to progress further? In my role as a husband, father, son, friend, psychotherapist, business and NGO consultant, and a seeker of universal wisdom, one single common denominator has become clear to me. One shared by constitutions, corporate cultures, psychotherapeutic schools, families, and even individuals in different cultures. These are values. Values are the common denominator. How do we define values? To date, there's no uniformly accepted definition of values. That fact alone can be taken as a clear indication of the true depth and complexity of human existence. A definition of Clemens Zetnak describes values as highly emotional charged ideas about what is desirable with relatively general and permanent evaluation criteria. That means values are abstract concepts that provide us with orientation and guide us into the future. But at the same time, they are rooted in important lessons from our past. They become fixed stars in the dark night, serving as a compass and showing us the way. in different situations and contexts, values remain stable over a long period of time. Nevertheless, over time, with new experiences and greater maturation, new values may press further towards the forefront. There's a world of difference between the 18-year-old just leaving home and the 65-year-old retiree entering the final chapters of his life. Certain values remain unchanged, while others either gain or lose significance. If we base our definition on the model of the researcher Shalom Schwartz, values reflect a synthesis of polarities. Our whole life takes place between polarities, male, female, light, dark, hot, cold, positive, negative, etc. The tension between the poles generates movement, meaning that if we really want something, there's a tension between the actual state of reality and the desired target state. The Latin verb movere, from which the word motivation derives its meaning, means to set in motion. As such, we should be able to see that motivation is always the result of an internal process, internal attitudes, and the difference between what the reality is and what we want it to be. Clearly, motivation comes from within. That's an interesting point to note. The union of contrasts creates movement, creates integration, and finally creates wholeness. However, as soon as we tend too strongly towards one pole, negative effects are triggered. The same principle applies to values. Let's take a look at the Schwartz value scale. We have on the one hand self-enhancement and on the other hand self-transcendence. The second scale is on the one hand the openness to change and conservation. If we were now unliterally emphasize one pole too strongly, for example, if we were to exaggerate attachment while neglecting our own autonomy in partnership, we would find ourselves creating dependency and artificially limiting ourselves. Conversely, if we exaggerate our own autonomy, we create distance and lose attachment. What does it mean for marriage and family? How can we outline a value process? First of all, it's our duty to become aware of our own values. We must make certain to orient our values toward meaning in our lives. If we link our value system to a mere checklist without considering our feelings, values are powerless and meaningless. We remain at the surface level of our personality. Second, identify your roles and what they mean with regard to your values and your behavior. If we have established our values clearly, it is then necessary to take this information from the abstract and integrate it into our daily life. What's the attitude towards life that we derive from integrating our values, and in which behaviors is our attitude evident? Third, ask yourself what implications your values have for your three life environments, family, work, and connections. Define your values based on your family. Using the example of family and collaborating with your partner and subsequently with your children, it would be possible to define common partner or family values, a family mission statement. In my family, for example, in an exciting process over months. We all five family members were included with that was a family mission statement for ourselves. The participatory process here was at least as important as the values we ultimately defined. In other words, the process is just as important as the result. Having outlined how values can be worked out, let's have a look at how civil society, NGOs, and faith-based organizations can contribute to strengthening personality, family, and nations. According to research carried out by Will Arts and Luke Hellman in the framework of the European Values Study, in Austria as well as in the rest of Europe. Traditional normative religious values are declining across generations. We can see in Austria the Catholic, the Roman Catholic and Protestant churches with the values they transmit are becoming more and more disconnected from the Austrian people. Thus, a traditional set of values that once provided a degree of security and influenced human development and families is disappearing. But who transmits values now? Schools? Businesses? A value vacuum emerges, which in the end will lead to a search for meaning and orientation, often sought in other spiritual movements. As Eric Fromm once said, we are free from something but do not yet know exactly what. In summary, we usually only put our values into practice in our daily lives at a subconscious level. Thus, values mostly remain below the threshold of our consciousness. So self-reflection, external stimuli and feedback, we can become aware of our own values. That is to say that our values become perceptible and visible to us, just as the contents of a dark room only become visible to us when the light is turned on. By becoming consciously aware of our own values, we can use them as tools to help us along in our daily lives. Therefore, it is necessary to develop programs for individuals, couples, and families that help us learn about and gain a deeper understanding of our individual values and our individual selves. The self-knowledge gained in the process subsequently helps us to shape our relationships in an autonomous, mature manner with more freedom and sustainability. We move away from the delusion that our partner is responsible for our happiness in life, which often leads to emotional overload and to divorce. We move away from the notion that others are responsible for our lives and we are victims of circumstance, of situation or other people. Thus, impulses are given in such a way that people are more fully autonomous and are therefore able to cultivate healthier relationships. The process essentially renews our relationships on the foundation of each individual's own more mature personality. Consciously developed common values lead families to shared powerful images and impulses, providing direction and clarity for the core building blocks of society when it comes to decisions, conflicts, and goals. By developing and communicating values, NGOs and faith-based organizations in particular can assume a great responsibility in order to strengthen personalities, families, and nations, and thereby contribute to the further evolution of mankind. As stated in the beginning, values determine our lives, whether we like it or not. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Joseph Misseton. Now we come to our last speaker from this panel. We had also another lady who should have come, who is not here, and she's Mrs. Yardaze Kombanvans. Yes? Anyway, she's in Africa. She has been called for a mission in Africa, I think. Yeah. So she has a one representative here of her. Mm. She's over there. The young one, very young. This lady is who's supposed to be here, Secretary General for the Youth World, Young Women, Christian Association. Young Women Christian Association. Okay. So we come to our next speaker, is Mr. Timothy Miller, who is the Vice President of Family Federation for World Peace and Unification in Europe. So he's also a children and family social worker for many years, a board member South East England Faith Forum. He's also currently health and social care coordinator, British Red Cross, East Sussex. Yes. So Tim Miller.
Good afternoon, everybody. Nice to see you. As mentioned, I'm on the board for the Faiths Forum, the Southeast of England. It's the whole Southeast of England except for London. few years back, one of their first tasks when they were getting government funding was to do a survey of the contribution of religious people to the charitable and voluntary sector in that part of the country. And it's staggering how much people of religious conviction contribute through their voluntary action and through their charitable work. And one thing I always really want to encourage is that, you know, we need confidence that people of religious conviction are many times huge contributors. As I came in on the train from the airport yesterday evening, just going by on the train, I saw the sign, Salvation Army. You know, one of the buildings there, and we have a local Salvation Army as well where I live. I think of so many religious bodies that express their relevance to society through their giving, but in their giving didn't lose their conviction, but strengthened it and found the energy to maintain it. And I think that's also enormously important. And actually, in an era where religion is increasingly less attractive to young people, it's crucially important that religious people are socially engaged. Very, very important. I've been very encouraged where I live. I live in a town which is part of a broader area with maybe 250,000, 300,000 people. My town has about 100,000 people in it. But in this town and the neighboring town, local Christians become increasingly socially active. For example, we have a project called the Street Pastors Project. I don't know if you're aware of this in other communities, but our local Christians staff a service on Friday night and Saturday night for young people who are coming out of the clubs and the pubs, the drinking places, to keep them safe from, you know, 11 o'clock at night till 5 o'clock in the morning. And the police are so profoundly grateful for their input. And it's made such a sense of worth and value to the local Christian community and created a collaboration belong denomination, which is enormously important. I also spent time as a trustee for my local council for voluntary services. In my little town of less than 100,000 people, there are 800 voluntary organizations. And I was on the body that helped support and, you know, help those voluntary organizations to work well. I also spent about 6 years up to 2005 working as a children and family social worker. Part of that time was spent working in a therapeutic community. We looked after 12 children under the age of 12 years old. It took 20 staff, plus highly skilled professional input, and cost in excess of 4,000 euros per month to look after each one of those 12 children. Just think what that means. And working as I did, supporting foster families, I was dealing with children who were no longer with their birth families. They were placed in other families who did, in many cases, a marvelous job in trying to create stability from great instability. Because what a contradiction it is. In one way, your parents are the source of your life, your very identity. On the other way, those parents were also the source of abuse and enormous insecurity. So I saw those kids as they were taken to contact, supervised contact. I supervised contact for kids with their physical parents who were not able to be with them, and saw the disruption that caused afterwards when they went back to their foster carers. Currently, just this last year, I'm working with the Red Cross, helping to increase community resilience. What does that mean? It means supporting and recruiting volunteers to go in and support carers in their own homes. And this, of course, is 60% to do with elderly people. Often one elderly person looking after another who's now got dementia. Other cases, looking after elderly parents who are taking care of a 50-year-old son with huge disability issues. Incredible, incredible devotion that's being manifested in that way. Anyway, what's this got to do with my picture? Well, I want to really advocate for the contribution that the voluntary sector and the people of religious conviction make to our society. And we need to speak up for what we do, otherwise we will have this situation where people just don't recognize our value and young people don't see the value. Same as with marriage and family. Tomorrow is my wedding anniversary. It's 32 years since my wedding. I was married in a wedding like that. I was married in Madison Square Garden, where you normally have basketball or boxing, with 2,000 other couples. And most of those, nearly all of those couples were international. Many of them were interracial. Some of them were between people from different religious backgrounds. But at that point in time, we were all people of the same faith. What faith? I'm a unificationist, I'm a follower of the Reverend Sun Myung-moon. Very controversial at that time, but it made such an impact on New York City. 4,000 people in, you know, dark suits and white wedding dresses walking down the street to Madison Square Gardens. And we had just an amazing expression of our idealism, because that event was all dedicated to world peace through the family. And I was an idealistic person in my, you know, late 20s, really convinced that, you know, we would transform the world through our commitment to go beyond enmity. My wife's German. First time I met my father-in-law, it was an easy experience because of the enemy background. My father-in-law was in the SS. He was also on the Russian front. He said to me, I can speak English, but I'm never going to speak to you in English. But actually, we had a very good relationship, and I learned that this was actually a very wonderful human being. So I directly experienced within my own family the going beyond difference. My wife also experiencing, because when we moved to where we live now, having had very profound experiences previously in London working with black people, my wife had very profound experiences working with the Jewish community where I live, and which led to the point where, you know, huge, profound reconciliation took place between herself and people who had fled from Nazi Germany and had very terrible, I can't go into the whole story, but very profound experiences. Anyhow, that marriage I was in 1982, that was just people of my faith. International, interracial, and background interreligious, but just people of my faith. But then 10 years later in 1992, our founder asked us to bring people not just from our own faith, from all religious backgrounds, to a much larger event of 30,000 couples in the stadium that was used just 4 years previously. Four years previously for the Olympic Games in Seoul. And I traveled there on a jumbo jet with a very mature Muslim couple, an even more mature Sikh couple. The husband was a famous professor of ecology. His wife was an agony aunt for the Asian community, and also a mature Christian couple. And we participated, sitting in the outside of the stadium, rededicating our marriages, but at the same time giving our support to thousands of young couples who were on the floor of the stadium, making their marriage commitment for the first time. And it was just extraordinary how that celebration of marriage and family impacted us and created a sense of working together. And this is the other thing I really want to talk about. Myself, I got involved in my faith, and one very influential factor in that was because I think religion has no credibility if people can't go beyond denomination and can't even go beyond faith in cooperating with one another. So I think one contribution, a unique contribution, Unification Movement or Family Federation for World Peace and Unification, which is the name of our religion now, can make is in bringing together people of different faith backgrounds in this matter of marriage and family. Because almost without exception, faiths share very similar views. I notice how difficult it is for sometimes us to go over the barrier, well, when I was younger, of denominational difference within Christianity, and now of difference of religion. But in the last 25 plus years of working interreligiously, I've had enormously positive experiences working beyond faith difference and finding and discovering through sharing common tasks the incredible value of other human beings who dress very differently, who worship very differently, who go through very different ceremonies, who have a different set of scriptures, but have profoundly beautiful character. This is 20 years later again. This is 2012, the last such large wedding event that our founder, Father Moon, presided over with his wife. His wife did again just this year and the year before. But I think it's so crucially important that we work together beyond faith difference. And if we do that, not only will we strengthen the cause for marriage and family, which we all hold so dear, but actually we will also find ways to value and appreciate one another beyond difference, which will be a saving grace, you know, for the future of our world, I really believe. Okay, that's just my first slide. I better get on to another one. Anyhow, here's, you know, those events turned into occasions not just officiated over by my faith, but of course officiated over by representatives of different faiths who gave their blessing on that occasion. So, in other words, we need to reach beyond our comfort zone. And for me, it was a big challenge, in a sense, to invite into our deeply important religious ceremony people of other faiths. It was a huge challenge, but a very important challenge, which led me particularly into the interreligious experience. Anyhow, in a sense, when we're gathered here together, as the British would say, we're singing to the choir. In other words, we all here appreciate marriage and family. But we do need to find the ways to present it that make, you know, huge impact and convince people of the importance of upholding these values. For me, post-Second World War, our part of the world, our rich world, has been almost obsessed with economy. But I have no doubt about it whatsoever. Those children in the therapeutic community, 4,000 euros each for, you know, for a month. I mean, there's no more important place to hold value than in the family. Because the capacity to love, and especially to make commitments and sustain them through difficulty, this is very hard to gain, quick to lose, and very difficult to recover. So, you know, the store of lasting love in a family, if you lose it, if you see a society where, I think Stephen was mentioning that in his talk, where the capacity to build a lasting relationship of love is diminishing, not increasing, we have hugely expensive, in terms of human pain and also in terms of cost, future that lies ahead of us. In the end, let's face it, you know, however much we have ideals, however much we have wonderful institutions like the UN or humanitarian organizations or people of religious conviction, what matters in the end is the quality of the people who staff and lead those organizations. I'm deeply impressed now working, I worked for many years for UPF and FFWP, Family Federation, and International, I'm now working with the Red Cross. The thing that impresses me most is the quality of the people involved. Because they're not there for the money, usually because they don't get much. Isn't that extraordinary? Some of the most caring and important giving roles in our society, people earn very little money, but they're profoundly motivated. One of them was working, one of my colleagues now is working in the world of high finance and banking before, and he said, it saved my life to join the Red Cross. I get much less money, but I'm doing something that really is in tune with my heart and my desire. So, you know, it's human character, which is largely shaped by experiences in the family as well as the surrounding educational systems of society, which determines our capacity. So we do also together need to work out a sort of ideology of the family. And I don't think that the Family Federation has a monopoly on that at all, but maybe we have something to offer. One thing I like to offer, because I was very involved in this sort of conference for many years, and I worked a lot with the Ambassadors for Peace movement that works with UPF, and that was people of very diverse religious backgrounds. So I learned to give presentations that didn't just come from biblical scriptural background, but from a whole variety of scriptures. Anyhow, much of our view or ideology of family is based on Genesis 1:28, and the blessings of God saying to Adam and Eve, become fruitful, multiply, have dominion. And it relates to somehow how we find peace. And that relates also to my colleague who just spoke before me. And this whole concept of religion's capacity to help people to find peace within themselves. And, you know, what I would express very much in that is our ideals, you know, springing from God and religious conviction, don't become reality just because we believe in them. They become reality when we practice them, when the thoughts become deeds and actions, or where mind and body meet. So the crucial place is not the realm just of belief and thought, but it's actually
in daily life where thought and deed become one. And that's actually the place the good character is formulated. So it's enormously important, but it's also the case when you, that becomes the precondition actually for good marriages. If we don't have the maturity to be able to love unselfishly, if we don't have the maturity to think of the other before myself, it's very unlikely we're gonna make a successful marriage. So we bring that first level of peace, as it were, to the next level. And the critical area is, how do husband and wife meet? You know, under what motivation do they meet? I would say definitely their motivation has to be rooted in their ideals. And this is fundamentally the function that religion has been carrying out. It's calling us to make families and marriages and live lives which are pleasing not just to me, but for the sake of pleasing God and higher ideals, and for the sake of the wider community. So I think, you know, when I was in that marriage for world peace, I was convinced that my marriage was contributing to world peace. I think it's very important we see the context of my daily life within a wider sense of responsibility for how we're benefiting the society and how we're benefiting the wider world. So much more to say about that, but, you know, making my own good family is not just for my own sake. It is to make my parents happy. It is to make grandparents happy. It is to make my wider family and society. And if you have that sense, it gives you a lot more of that determination to see through the inevitable difficult and challenging moments. Not only that, when in such families we raise people who have capacities to love and live for others, they bring that capacity into their wider life. They bring it into their economic life, for example. They bring it into their business practice. You know, they bring it into the way they deal with their possessions and their wealth and their sense of giving and generosity to wider people. It impacts our relationship, human relationship with the natural world. I am a person of religious conviction. I do believe that God created us and created an incredibly beautiful world for us to live in. But obviously, it's critically important that we relate to that world in a way that's sensitive to God, thoughtful of future generations, if we're going to have enduring peace and prosperity. So I have no question also but that religious people have a huge contribution to make to making our world a sustainable world, and a world where we respect and care for the natural world. But that's rooted, in terms of actual daily practice, it's not rooted just in beliefs, it's rooted in how you develop character and how you develop daily practice. And where's that learned? That's learned through living example. Where's the first place of living example? Unquestionably, it's in the family and the circles of relationship that surround the family. So, you know, of these three blessings from God to us, which we need to substantiate in our lives and return to God, I have no doubt whatsoever that it's the middle one which is the most central. Because that is the most extraordinary place. I don't think there's a pointer on this. You know, when you see that place where husband and wife meet, you know, in my beliefs theology, that is such a sacred place. I believe it's so in many, many different religious convictions. Because that's, in a sense, the place where man and woman meet. That's the place where God comes down and love turns into life. What an amazing miracle when love turns into life. And how important it is how that meeting takes place, and it's the right place for love to turn into life and life to be nurtured. So, you know, that meeting place ideally is the place that God comes down on earth and the love of God passes to the next generation. So, you know, one thing that our founder is very hot on is love. But actually, he's even more concerned about lineage. His expression is love, life, and lineage. Which do you think has most value? Many people think it's love. However, no matter how valuable love and life are, they're horizontal in nature. What on earth does he mean by that? They appear and conclude within one generation. On the other hand, lineage is vertical in nature and continues forever, generation after generation. So this is the challenge. I look at my Mormon friends here, and I look at my own religious community, and we are barely heading in this part of the world as a religious community into our second and third generation. The big challenge will be, can we substantiate our values and pass them to our children and to our children's children? This will be the crucial factor. And then what I see amongst my children's school friends, as they were growing up, my children are grown up now, but when I saw their school friends, isn't it remarkable
how some people have the fortune of a family background and a character that makes it apparently so much easier for them to get on with others, while other people it's very, very difficult. As I said, I work with children who have been sexually, emotionally, physically abused. I'm not saying that's an irrecoverable situation. And some of the foster families I work with and some people in the therapy community, we help people to recovery. But it's mighty difficult to recover. So the things that we pass from generation to generation are hugely important. And we are in an incredibly dangerous position as a wealthy Western society that has the benefit of a long 2,000-year religious history, even further back than that through Judaism. We are in great danger of losing all of that huge historical benefit that we have. So just, I don't have time to go through all of these. You can have the presentation. I've got quotes here. You'll just see them flash out from Judaism, from Islam, from Hinduism, from Christianity, from Buddhism, from Confucianism, from the I Ching. And here, I'll just read the last one. African traditional thought. This is a prayer that's said at a wedding. My father, thank you for showing me affection. My mother, thank you for making me comfortable. Thank you for clothing me with wisdom, which is more important than providing me with clothes. So, you know, there's so much wisdom. There's the wisdom that endured through centuries. It's talking about truths which aren't a matter of fashion. I think we need to create a fashion, right? Because we need to swing the pendulum back towards realizing the importance of these matters. But, you know, we share it in common as people of ethical and religious conviction. Also, as a movement, we're very into purity before marriage, we're very into fidelity within marriage. But it's tough to maintain it in this society, right? But I have no question about it. If you want to learn to make commitment, you don't learn it by practicing relationships and breaking them time and time again as the foundation for securing a committed relationship between husband and wife. You establish a commitment which enable you to be a lasting husband and wife through actually showing commitment in your previous relationships. Okay, anyhow, I'm out of time. Come back to that. Where's the secure place to store our wealth? Not our money, not our banks, we know about that, but actually in the generations of family. Thank you.
We should finish at 6 o'clock, right? Is there is a specific time to finish? So there's no question answer, right? Is there is time for question answer? Is there is
couple questions, but also don't forget tomorrow we'll have.
Yeah, that's right. Tomorrow we have more time.
Couple questions is fine.
Yeah, okay. Tomorrow we'll have more time to have question answer, to discuss more, to exchange more. So at least, or if you have one question, just one? That's all right. So thank you very much to our speakers. So we'll
Heiner, tomorrow, do we expect to wait as long as today to get into it? Or okay.
Thank you all. Thank you all for today's hard work. It is hard work, actually. But just general information, tomorrow you have your badge. So you come in directly to the line where there is, you can go directly to the security check-in with the, they let you through the machine and check you out. I would like to request just the speakers from the international who came here from various places of Europe just to come here for a second. And anyway, for everybody else, we thank you very much for coming. We're looking forward to seeing you all here tomorrow. And it's going to be more exciting because it's going to be more interactive. So thank you very much, and please, all the international speakers and staff, please come up front here for a second.
I think we're here, huh?
That includes you.
Tim, this is super.
Thank you very much.
Great lecture. Yeah. Great lecture. Wonderful.
It's about dinner. How did you?